So first of all, securitization of the environment, I would just like to throw light on some of the schools that have dealt with the environmental security broadly. First is Copenhagen School, which of course comes to everyone's mind when you talk about the whole securitization theory, because this is the school which essentially introduced the sectoral security analysis and the speech act, wherein you have the securitizer, the audience, and how the two have to come together to make any kind of a securitization move successful. So Copenhagen School is the first one, or there has been, of course, environmental security discourse before that as well. But when it comes to the securitization debate, whether it should be securitized or not, Copenhagen School was probably one of the foremost schools to talk about it in a much broader sense. For example, Barry Guzan, he defines environmental security as the maintenance of the local and planetary biosphere as the essential support system on which all other human enterprises depend. So for the Copenhagen School, environmental security is definitely the base on which the other sectors, which they also defined as the political, the military, the societal, these sectors also depend. So if you want to secure the entire system, you need to secure the environmental sector much more proactively. That's what the Copenhagen School came up with. Coming on to the Welsh School, which deals with more of critical security studies, so it's more about the broadening and deepening of security studies rather than treating the state as a referent object. So you're not trying to protect only the state, you're also trying to protect the individuals, you're also trying to protect societies, communities. So Welsh School spoke about a much broader way of looking at security, security aspects, even in terms of defining the threats. So threats are not just external, threats might be also internal. So for example, environmental threats need not come from another state. It emerges from within. So you need to redefine threats as well according to Welsh School. And that is why it gave more importance to human and community security. It talked about progress and emancipation, because for Welsh School, it's not just enough to be alleviated from the fear of any kind of threat. It's also about the progress and emancipation. You need to have the means to progress in your life. That's more important, and only then you can be secure. It's not just enough to eliminate the so-called enemy. This kind of the language was completely sort of was questioned by the Welsh School, whereas Copenhagen School was more very state-oriented and state-centric. Within Welsh School, there is a lot of discussion on this concept, on this debate of environment versus development. So environment versus development is more pertinent in the case of developing countries, because we tend to talk about this kind of a zero-sum game between these two, because one thing comes at the expense of the other. So Welsh School talks about how there has to be a middle ground somewhere where you can have environmental conservation and where you can have developmental processes going hand in hand, and rather than having to compromise one in favor of the other. Finally, the Risk School, which is more recent, but it is also very pertinent when it comes to the whole debate on climate change and environmental security. So Risk School talks about, there is one aspect of Risk School which says that risk and security are pretty much the same. There is this risk-security nexus. But at the same time, there are others who say that the process of riskification, the so-called riskification, is very different from the process of securitization, which deals more with threat rather than risk. So within this Risk School, you have people like Corey, for example, who talks about Olaf Corey. He's also from the Copenhagen School, in fact. He talks about the conditions for possibility of harm rather than direct causes for harm. So even when it comes to environmental issues, you're not trying to defend yourself. In fact, the next point over there, govern rather than defend. So you're not trying to defend yourself against environment. You're trying to govern the situation, you're trying to govern the conditions under which certain threats might emerge, and so these are risks. These are risks in the long term, they're not yet threats. So you are trying to govern the situation so that the crisis does not emerge in the long run. So that is why the long-term preventive, precautionary and preemptive measures are more important in the risk school rather than short-term urgent and extraordinary measures. So Copenhagen School, for example, talks about very extraordinary measures that you have to undertake when an issue is securitized, whereas risk school says that it could be either a double kind of a securitization process, or it could be more of just governing the issue so that crisis does not develop in the long run. Coming on to the global research on environmental security, this is taken from one of the articles of Ron Felt, and he divides basically the whole research in this area into three different periods. So the scholarly approach, based on the scholarly approach, field of analysis and the level of analysis. So in the early 1980s, this was the time when the whole environmental security debate started gaining momentum after books like The Silent Spring by Rachel Carson and a lot of other environmental movements became very prominent in the West especially. So it was at that time that some of the academics started picking up this topic and said that there is a lot of connection between environment and security, and you need to build some kind of literature which talks about these aspects as well and not just the military threats or the so-called military threats. And that is why the conceptual debate about how to build those interlinkages between environment and security, whether it's interstate war or or ethnic clashes within a state, or all these things started being discussed at a very nascent level. And that is why the level of analysis here is very broad. It talks about the global security, it talks about the state security, it also talks about individual security. The second generation, which started in the early 1990s, that was the time when the Cold War had ended, and there was a lot of criticism of how environment and security cannot be really connected, and therefore a lot of academics started to do empirical research. They wanted empirical findings to show that actually these are connected. You can pick up a few examples here and there, but the quantitative analysis which was required to prove that environmental scarcity can cause conflict, you know, that was very important for the second generation of researchers. Especially you can talk about Homer Dixon of Canada and also Beckler of Switzerland. So these are the people who are known for the second generation of researchers. But for them, it is very important to note here that the level of analysis is state and sub-state. They never really felt that there could be an interstate war. There could be sort of a war between the North and the South over resources and things like that. They always maintained that these clashes, ethnic clashes or so-called civil conflicts can happen only within a state due to environmental scarcity. Now, coming on to the third generation, which started in the mid-90s, there was a lot of criticism of the second generation as well, because it actually tried to say that, or it actually, the whole causal thing was very simplistic, because it said that, okay, environmental scarcity will cause conflict. Okay, they tried to, just make it a little more complex by saying that it may not be the direct cause, it could be the threat multiplier, it could be the catalyst, so called. But because of this rather simplistic way of looking at the whole environment conflict nexus, the third generation came up with a broad range of social science methodologies to again sort of go back to the whole conceptual debate and mix it with empirical evidence to show that they are indeed connected. And here you have the global coming into action again. So that's when, for example, climate security is one such subject which became very prominent in the 90s, because a lot of initiatives were taken to securitize climate change, about how it will affect human security, how it will affect national security and the global security at large, and even the regional. So you can see that the level of analysis even the regional level came into prominence. This was the first time that regional security in terms of environment also started to be discussed. So this is just a table which shows how environment has been securitized at various levels. It's It's very interesting to see that that there is not one interpretation of environmental security. There's just too many. In fact, even this is too simplistic of how you can look at it.